right now of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, one of the most holy sites in all of the Christian faith. And from here, he will walk to the Western Wall, the holiest site for the Jewish religion. How is the world perceiving this trip? Let's get the bottom line with the host of CNN's Fareed Zakaria GPS. Fareed Zakaria joins us now. Fareed, it's interesting. Again, as we were looking at those pictures moments ago, the president of Israel, Reuven Rivlin, welcomed President Trump by saying, "America is back." America is back. That's an interesting notion, and one I think the Obama administration would dispute. It's like, we never left, but the perception there is this is a return to something that has been missing.
Well, clearly the Trump administration and Donald Trump has decided what they're going to do is try to have a much more overtly pro-Sunni Arab foreign policy. That means supporting countries like Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, Egypt, and try to kind of help solidify the already emerging partnership between those Sunni Arab countries and Israel. The big foe, of course, being Iran in that circumstance. So the Sunni Arab states, the Saudis, the Emiratis, and the Israelis welcome this. They think it's a, you know, it's a good idea. Part of what's going on here is, you know, we have to remember countries like to flatter the incoming president. Obama got a whole bunch of this when he was first president. The Europeans were falling over themselves. The Turks were falling over themselves. Egypt at the time, well, given this, you know, extraordinary lion's welcome when he came and gave his Cairo speech. So there's some of this one. I hope that the Trump administration is sophisticated enough to understand there is a feeling in diplomacy. If you think flattery doesn't get you anywhere, you haven't been properly flattered.
But is this the right time to marginalize Iran, given that Rouhani was just reelected and that signals that Iranians want to be more modern? They want a more moderate voice.
That's, I think, the most interesting, important question about American foreign policy in the Middle East going forward. Can you really construct a stable Middle East by completely excluding Iran, by essentially having an anti-Shia foreign policy? Remember, it's not just Iran. Iraq is a Shia-majority country, and the United States has an alliance with a Shia country. Right now, what you have is a Middle East out of balance between the Shias and the Sunnis. You see that playing out in Syria, in Iraq, in Yemen. Almost all over, you have these tensions. You probably need to find some kind of stability that does involve both sides. You can't just have, you know, a policy toward one. But as I say, for now, the Sunni, I remember, he's talking to a very small number also. These are the Saudis, the Emiratis, the Egyptian elites. They're very happy about it. The interesting thing is that even in the speech he gave in Israel, he talked about Iran as if it was to blame for the rise of Al-Qaeda. The core problem we have faced, which has been radical Islamic terrorism, to say the words that Donald Trump would not say, is a Sunni problem. It's a problem created by these very Sunni autocrats.
Saudi Arabia.
Saudi Arabia is the birthplace. It is the place where 15 of the 19 9/11 bombers came from. It's Osama bin Laden's birthplace. It is the place that has funded and fueled most of the radical Islamic terrorism the United States has faced. Actually, Iran has not. So that's the tension here.
And in terms of the message he delivered to Saudi Arabia on that subject, not dissimilar to what we had heard from President Obama, you know, previously. Right now, as we speak, the president is inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. He will walk. He will make a 10-minute walk to the Western Wall. What's the significance, Fareed, do you think, of this sort of religious pilgrimage that President Trump is making with the whole world watching?
I think that Trump is doing something symbolic that is, I think, important. It's important whenever the American president goes to demonstrate a sort of respect for any country's most important sites, and particularly religious sites. I think it's just symbolic, but symbolism is powerful, and I think it's important that he does it with Christianity, with Judaism. I think to a certain extent he did it with Islam as well. As you said, the speech that he gave about Islam was frankly one that Barack Obama could have given. He in fact even used the same terminology. He said Islamist extremism. Obama tended to say Islamism or violent extremism. Neither of them chose to use radical Islamic terrorism. You might recall last year when Obama said radical Islamic terrorism, well, refused to say radical Islamic terrorism, Donald Trump tweeted, "Obama should resign in disgrace because he refuses to use the phrase radical Islamic terrorism." Well, he had the opportunity, and President Trump also chose not to say it. probably for the same reasons. So that sense of a reality check is becoming clear on this trip, that Donald Trump has recognized that it's one thing to tweet as a candidate. When you're president, you do have to show respect for countries and faiths.
Fareed Zakaria, thank you for the bottom line. Great to have you here.
Pleasure.